What's up, everybody? This is Chris and Connor, and we're here to talk to you about the Pulse's newest podcast, The Heartbeat.
We're going to be trying to publish a new podcast every other week with a new interview and a new hot take.
Yeah, so first episode will be premiering today, and it's an interview with Zach Leonsis, class of 2007, who's currently the vice president and general manager of Monumental Sports Network. Please enjoy.
Sounds good.
Awesome. All right, so getting us started, in the past year, Monumental Sports has created not one but two AFL teams, and the Brigade and then also the Valor. What gave you guys the confidence to invest in the market of the AFL?
So, you know, the AFL is an interesting opportunity for us. We actually had the opportunity to add an AFL team a couple times previously in the past 5 years. And those last couple times we passed. We passed because the league was in bad shape. It didn't have, I would say, too many owners with staying power or any other ownership groups that really operated other large professional sports organizations like ours. But then in sort of the most recent past, we had the opportunity to meet with the brand new commissioner, Scott Butera, and we coordinated closely with a couple of sort of fellow or colleague NHL owners who also had AFL teams, in Jeff Vinnick, who owns the Tampa Bay Lightning, and then it was Dan Gilbert in Cleveland, who owns the Cleveland Cavaliers. And they both gave ringing endorsements of the commissioner and also just the actual game product itself. It's a really unique game in that it's in the summer, so it's out of the NFL season. It's incredibly high scoring. It's very affordable. A great sort of summer alternative to baseball, indoors and the like. And when we came and we started the Washington Valor, you know, we were ready to kick off, you know, heading into the season, and then it became very clear that we would have the opportunity to really be in the driver's seat for a lot of things that would help shape the league and really restart the league from scratch. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, there are six different committees at the league level, and we're chairman of five of those six.
Okay.
So we're doing a lot in terms of pushing the league into developing its own over-the-top platform for AVOD and SVOD distribution. We're doing deals with Sports Radar. Sports Radar is one of the biggest data providers for sports data out there. Mm-hmm. And then also, you know, trying to find ways to incorporate fantasy and gaming into the AFL product as well. I think that we really saw this as an opportunity to say, hey, if you were essentially starting a league from scratch, how would you shape it? You know, let's take the best things of the leagues that we operate in and see if we can make something really special, because we think that these teams, which right now are, you know, relatively affordable to purchase when compared to an NBA or an NHL team, let's see if we can really drive and create a lot of value here. And because the franchises weren't, you know, $1 billion to purchase like an NBA team, mm-hmm. It's low risk for us to do so. And we already had the infrastructure in place in terms of our, you know, customer data and being able to reach out to people. And we've got full-time employee staff that we were able to scale out. Obviously, have the Caps and Wizards, but we also have the Mystics.
Yeah.
There were some synergies that we had the opportunity to create sort of a summer sales force and what we call our franchises team that now just focuses on sales and marketing for the Valor, the Brigade, and the Mystics. Mm-hmm. And just based on all of our work happening with the Valor, we thought, let's double down. We've always wanted a big footprint in Baltimore. This finally gives us a real entity operating in Baltimore. And we really subscribe to the theory of sort of the greater Washington area evolving into a super city. Mm-hmm. And that super city combines Washington and Baltimore. I think when, you know, Kevin Plank goes to recruit people to work at Under Armour, he doesn't say, oh yeah, we're in Baltimore. He says, we're in the greater Washington region. Mm-hmm. There's some connectivity, I think, that just naturally occurs between our two cities. And we also thought it'd be a great opportunity to develop a new rivalry in our game. It's easy to imagine a great rivalry forming between Washington and Baltimore, and you could sell, you know, group ticket packages that take advantage of the two teams, and do, you know, sponsorship deals with the Sella, ship people back and forth for the games, and it kind of went into our theory that we could really experiment here, we could really be in the driver's seat, and I think we're making a lot of progress in terms of what we initially wanted to do. We're going to launch an OTT platform, we've got these other deals in place. I think that this upcoming season will be, you know, a bit of a continued workout experience, but we do feel very positive about other conversations we're having with potential ownership groups that are only NHL or NBA operators. And there's some sincere interest in potentially joining this league, which obviously is good for everyone. So it's an exciting opportunity. It's a very unique one. It's one that we've spent a lot of time on. It's definitely been a workout, but I think it's been a project that's been very worthwhile so far.
All right.
This is Connor, by the way. On occasion, I'll find myself like watching an AFL game on TV, and it's like, it's really fun to watch. It's a totally different game than the NFL. What type of fans does the AFL and like new teams that you obviously have purchased and created cater to? Why do you think they cater to those, that type of fan?
Yeah, so, you know, one of the big strategies that we really are trying to focus on at Monumental is how do we reach the next wave of sports fans? A lot of viewers and ticket purchasers, they're a little older, and we see that younger consumers are spending in very different ways. They're consuming media in very different ways, and they need to be catered to in different ways. Part of the reason why we launched an over-the-top subscription and AVOD platform in Monumental Sports Network, and it's also a reason why we invested in an esports team called Team Liquid, which competes across 9 different titles. Our big fear, and I think that the fear for, you know, marketers everywhere, is whiffing on the next generation of fans. And so in sort of the same theory of esports, where the action is constant, it's high scoring, and it caters to, you know, I'll speak for myself, my ADD nature, I can't take my eyes off the play. The AFL also fit into that thesis of ours. You know, you get scores that are between, you know, 60 and 80 points in the last 2 minutes. There might be 3 lead changes. There was the ability for us to do player tracking and put cameras in helmets, and just get greater access to the players. And all of this, we think, provides sort of an experience that millennials and Gen Z customers can really latch onto. It's affordable. We know that, you know, housing in DC is expensive, so disposable income isn't all that high. So we want the tickets to be very affordable. We want you to be able to start your night, your Friday or Saturday night at Verizon Center, and then by 9:15 you're out and you can go on with your night. You can treat it a bit as your pregame, your way to just kind of start things off. It's going to be a fun, rowdy experience. I can imagine, you know, us setting up party buses, you know, shipping fans up to Baltimore, shipping Baltimore fans down to Washington. I think the access to our players will be really authentic as well. All of the players are required to stay on the field for 30 minutes after the game to sign autographs and the
That's very cool.
You know, we know that millennials really skew high in terms of how much they value the experiential components. They're more willing to spend money on experiences rather than actual physical goods. Mm-hmm. And kind of what better experience in the summer than, you know, a high-scoring, fun football game.
Yeah.
People love football, and then you get to meet the players afterwards and take a selfie and,
yeah.
you know, you grab a couple hot dogs and enjoy a couple beers. I mean, that's a great, fun summer alternative.
Yeah.
And, you know, it's a 14-game season. There are only 7 home games, so there's some scarcity there, too.
Yeah.
I don't think it'll get diluted in terms of, like, oh, it's another AFL game. Mm-hmm. So I think it'll be a lot of fun. I think we're gonna pack the house on April 7th, which is our home opener against Baltimore. Pretty amazing coincidence that we have both of our new teams playing each other in the opener. It seems like this.
Yeah.
You know, we've been working on this project for a year and a half, so it's sort of a great way for us to sort of tie a bow on that chapter.
Yeah.
And get these teams up and running, which will be an incredibly satisfying experience because. You know, right now they feel a little bit like phantom teams. Now we're starting to get players in, and we have head coaches in place and brands developed, and we're selling tickets. Now they really feel like real teams. But until we actually see the teams play on April 7th, you know, there's still expansion teams, and we still got to get them launched. So it'll be a really fulfilling and satisfying experience to see them play, and we think it'll be super relevant for younger customers to come and enjoy.
All right, and then switching gears a little bit, at every like Wizards or Caps game I go to, I notice there's a substantial amount of in-game entertainment, whether it's like in between quarters or during timeouts. Can we expect the same amount of in-game entertainment at the AFL, if not more?
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. I think that, if anything, you might see more activations.
Mm-hmm.
Because, you know, in some of the leagues like the NBA and the NHL, the league has rules and regulations about some of the programming that can happen.
Yeah.
In the AFL, we're more in charge of writing what those rules should look like. And so we do want to experiment with some, you know, unique programming. Mm-hmm. In arena, hopefully also providing people with a really unique second screen experience.
Yeah.
While watching the game as well. But definitely, you can definitely expect a similar game day presentation. You know, we're unveiling mascots for both teams. The dance teams are selected.
All right, yeah.
We also need to kind of get to know the fans who come too and develop programming around their taste too. You know, we don't know what the organic chant will be yet, right? We need to sort of measure how that comes together. You know, if you go to a Caps game, you see, you know, Unleash the Fury. That's become such a great community rallying cry that's just kind of been fostered organically, and we obviously don't have that yet for either of the AFL teams. So, you know, we'll experiment. We'll try a bunch of stuff. We'll stop the stuff that we don't think is working well quickly, and we'll stick to things that maybe show some success.
All right. And this is kind of a follow up to that. There's a franchise in the Indoor Football League, which is like a few tiers below the AFL, and they basically were running the franchise with kind of like a really fan-based like view, and they're allowing like the fans to call plays for like every single play. Do you think we'll see a little bit of that with the Brigade or Valor, or not as much?
I've read that before, and you know, my answer would be no.
Okay.
I don't envision us going that far.
Yeah, probably for the best.
I also think that while that's an interesting experiment, and I'm looking forward to seeing how it goes, I think you do start to damage the integrity of the game and the product. I'm not sure if players really want, you know, somebody kind of playing with their careers like that.
I think
that there's a certain level of respect that you know, we need to have for the players, and the players who are playing in the AFL are really good. I mean, all of these guys got drafted into the NFL, and were cut. And a lot of these guys are trying to get back into the NFL. And that's really a lot of the promise that our coaches provide for these players. They say, this is a great opportunity to stay in shape, same football shape, to practice with the team, to get your reps, to showcase your stuff, to get back in the NFL when a player gets injured or whatnot. I mean, we have a couple guys on the Valor who have won Super Bowls in the NFL. And, you know, just for one reason or another, you know, fell out of the league. So all of these guys are really, really talented players. It's frankly another reason why we actually were attracted to the AFL game. There was no shortage of talent. The quality of play should be really good. But as a result, you know, we do need to show some respect because, you know, these guys, if every play was a Hail Mary, it also wouldn't be great to watch. We won't be going that far.
All right. Yeah, it makes sense.
Justin, as I've noticed, Monumental Sports has grown exponentially in recent years. And in the future, how much bigger do you think the network can become? Like, what do you think the potential is of it? And do you think it eventually could eventually become the primary provider of Wizards and Caps games?
So you're talking about our online digital platform, Monumental Sports Network. So yeah, so we definitely have grown dramatically. So in the fall, we struck a brand new regional agreement with CSN Mid-Atlantic and NBC Sports, where we acquired an equity position in the RSN. My dad and I sit on that board, and you know, we were able to increase our rights fee significantly for the team, for the Capitals and Wizards, which is really important. But then we also worked with NBC Sports to have them make a strategic investment in basically a platform where we could experiment and try to reach younger consumers with. And so, you know, we have been making some significant investment in the form of new teams, new networks, and the like, but they're all very complementary of each other, right? The network is good for the AFL teams because it gives them a platform to be broadcasted on. It get, you know, someone's going to cover them. It makes the teams relevant, and it was a major reason why we bought the teams in the first place, because it's good for the network to have these teams because it's more programming. It's more programming to include in a subscriber bundle. More content and programming is good content and programming for us. And so, yeah, I mean, right now we've got five teams going on a sixth. We will plan to add an NBA D League team. Now it's actually the G League because of a recent sponsorship that happened at the league level. So we will be adding an NBA G League team relatively soon, in the next couple of years. But we get opportunities all the time in terms of you know, new team opportunities, new startup leagues, and the like. And certainly we passed on a lot of those opportunities, but I wouldn't be surprised if we added, you know, more teams in the future that would be, you know, smaller scale, I would say classify as emerging leagues. You know, I think we've been open to fielding new opportunities and learning more. I think you can definitely expect us to continue to grow in the next couple of years.
And then moving on to some more like Potomac-based questions. You visited here last April. How has the school changed since you left?
Since I graduated?
Sorry.
Well, a couple things have changed. One, class sizes have gotten much larger. When I graduated, I think there were about 68 people in my class. Now I think the grade sizes are, 110? And then, you know, the middle school hadn't been redeveloped yet. And I know that that's complete. I've gotten to know the principal, Principal Kowalik, a little bit. He really seems fantastic. Really, really love hearing about his perspective and worldview on where the school should be heading. It was great to come to Potomac just a few, about a month ago or so, when we streamed the Potomac versus Flint Hill game. Good to see that the student section is still alive and well.
Yeah.
It's funny coming back as an alumni. Because I remember being your guys' age and seeing people who were, you know, graduated 10 years ago and saying, like, oh, my gosh, they're so old. Oh, my gosh, they used to, you know, basically school here. Like, you know, it's kind of hard to imagine. But it's amazing how many of the same faces you see. You know, Rob Lee is still an institution, right? David Grant, still an institution. It's really fun to see familiar faces. Mr. Peary, of course. it's awesome that sort of those core players are still very active and very much involved with the school.
Yep. All right. And then last question. Were there any teachers or faculty that influenced you in a particular way, or any teachers that you remain in contact with today?
Yeah, I mean, frankly, some of the names that I just mentioned. I mean, David Grant. We did a lot with the Community Service Club. Yeah. I was the leader of the club for 2 years. Really, sort of ignited my interest in service and really explained to me why it was so important to incorporate in my life. And we still do service opportunities today. For example, my team at Monumental, once a month we serve at a Martha's Table, Joyful Food Markets. Mm-hmm. We've really purposely programmed it into our schedules. Rob Lee, I think, was just fantastic. I mean, talk about the most upbeat, optimistic person on the planet. Encouraging. Really makes you want to go out and do your best. Mm-hmm. I remember Mr. Peary, when I was at Potomac, actually was doing intermediate school.
Yep.
And then I think it was my senior year that he jumped up and was having a more active role at the upper school and the high school. And, I mean, talk about a guy who can really tout integrity and character.
For sure.
His integrity ball speech still resonates with me today, even. Mr. Lindsay was my advisor. I love Mr. Lindsay. Again, just such a happy, just like warm personality. I think one of the greatest things about my experience at Potomac was how close I became with all the faculty. I mean, it's really a unique community and culture there that I think you don't really realize how nice that is until you go to college.
Definitely.
And you're in a classroom with 600 other students and you never meet your professor once. If you email the professor and you go, hey, I'd like to meet, I have a question or something, they may not even respond because they're too busy doing their own research and you're just sort of a pupil. You know, go meet with the TA, the teacher's assistant, if you have any questions. I'm busy with my research. That's sort of a little bit of a wake-up call, a little bit of a culture shock, I think, for probably, or at least it was for me, when I first went to school at University of Pennsylvania. That's something that, I hope students at Potomac really cherish and understand is special and unique.
All right. Well, thank you so much for this opportunity. We really appreciate it, and best of luck to you this year, and let's hope for some playoff wins for the Wizards and Caps.
Definitely.
Yeah, thanks, man. It'll be a lot of fun. Team's been playing really well. It's obviously been great to see the Caps be at the top of the league again. We are, quite frankly, swinging really hard this year. We all have our fingers crossed.
Yeah.
We're a really good team, and this team can do it. We're just going to have to see if it happens. So I can't wait for the playoffs. It's sort of a mix of excitement and nerves.
Yeah, for sure.
But we're ready to watch. And then the Wizards after – you know, the slow start that we had have obviously just made such a dramatic turnaround. It's been just fabulous to watch and enjoy, and the fact that we're only actually a few games out of first place in the East, it's remarkable, and nobody wants to play our team. Our team is really quick. Our team can shoot threes. And we're a confident bunch. We think we can go out and beat anyone. We've kind of developed a nice little rivalry with Boston right now, which has been a lot of fun to watch. I could imagine that being a great playoff series if the seeding matches up in later rounds if we're able to progress. It's been a great ride this year. A lot of fun, and to have both teams make the playoffs is really hard to do. We did that 2 years ago, and Verizon Center was just rocking for a month and a half. And hopefully, we can have a similar experience again.
All right, thank you. Have a good day.
Awesome. Thanks, guys.
Bye.